Barak Raviv is a major leader in many organizations, a major philanthropist, and a wonderful model for the future leadership of the Jewish community. Please welcome our chairman, Barak Raviv.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Barak Raviv, and it's my privilege to be the chair of the Campaign Advisory Council of the Western Region of the Shaar Tzedek Medical Center in Jerusalem, one of tonight's sponsors. It's also a great honor to have been asked to chair this evening's program. To say that what will be discussed tonight is timely is a great understatement. When our regional director, Paul Jesser, discussed the idea with the David Suissa, I don't think either one of them could have foreseen how very recent events have significantly changed what the original discussion, which was the effects of the recent Israeli elections, were going to be about. Tonight we begin by observing Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Remembrance Day. We must never forget what evil can do. To commemorate this horrible time in our history, I would like to share with you a prayer written by Elie Wiesel. I no longer ask you for either happiness or paradise. All I ask of you is to listen and let me be aware of your listening. I no longer ask you to resolve my questions, only to receive them and make them part of you. I no longer ask you for either rest or wisdom. I only ask you not to close me to gratitude, be it of the most trivial kind, or to surprise and friendship. Love is not yours to give. As for my enemies, I do not ask you to punish them or even to enlighten them. I only ask you not to lend them your mask and your powers. If you must relinquish one or the other, give them your powers, but not your countenance. They are modest, my requests, and humble. I ask you what I might ask a stranger met by chance at twilight in a barren land. I ask you, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to enable me to pronounce these words without betraying the child that transmitted them to me. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, enable me to forgive you and enable the child that once was to forgive me too. I no longer ask you for the life of that child, not even for his faith. I only beg you to listen to him and act in such a way that you and I can listen to him together. They are modest, my prayers, and humble. I ask you what I might ask a stranger met by chance at twilight in a barren land. Please rise for a moment of silence and remembrance. Thank you very much. Before I introduce our panel and moderator, I would like to call upon our host to say a few words. Ephraim Harkham is the president and CEO of Lux Hotels and founder of LWH Hotels, a collection of global boutique hotels. Lux Hotels includes this property, Lux Sunset Boulevard Hotel, the Lux Rodeo Drive Hotel in Beverly Hills, and the branded property Lux City Center in downtown Los Angeles. Born in Tel Aviv, raised in Australia, and now residing in LA, Ephraim is a supporter of many Jewish and Israeli-based organizations and institutions. The one word most used to describe Ephraim is mensch. We thank Ephraim for tonight's event. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Ephraim Harkham.
Thank you so much, Barak. And thank you for chairing this event and for supporting this organization and keeping it going and doing all that you do for our city and the Jewish community. And the beautiful poem by Elie Wiesel, how appropriate. So it's a pleasure, it's a major pleasure, really, to be associated with another event with Paul Jesser, Shaar Tzedek. Mr. Metloff is here, Steve Metloff, representing the Metloff family, and so proud to be associated with Jewish Journal. You guys have come a long way, and you look so good. David Suissa, you've done a great job. Rob, really, was so proud. And we have Shmuel Rosner, And Susan, it's really a pleasure to be with you and you, the audience, to take the time out to learn about this. As Barack said, we had no idea it was going to be this interesting tonight, because we thought the event was going to be about the election in Israel, not about what's going on right now in Washington and Israel. And so this is a very apropos that we're here tonight to learn and to move it forward and to be united as a people. We big challenge, a major, major challenge we're facing, Israel is facing, and the Jewish community. So this is very apropos, and I thank you so much for being here, and we look forward to a great event, a great evening tonight. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ephraim. You are the best, and we appreciate everything that you do. It's now my pleasure to introduce tonight's panel. There are three panelists, Rob Eshman, Shmuel Rosner, and David Suissa. Our moderator will be Susan Freudenheim. And to save valuable time, I'll share very short introductions. And if I missed anything in your bios, please let me know and I'll come back and say it. Rob Eshman is publisher and editor-in-chief of Tribe Media, a niche multimedia company based in Los Angeles. Rob started his career as a staff writer at the Jewish Journal in 1993 when it was a very small community paper. Shmuel Rosner is senior political editor for the Jewish Journal, and Rosner's domain, his daily blog, is hosted by the Jewish Journal. Shmuel is also a contributing opinion writer for the International New York Times. David Suissa, is president of Tribe Media and the Jewish Journal. Susan Freudenheim is the executive editor of the Jewish Journal of Greater Los Angeles. Susan has been executive editor since 2011 and served as managing editor from 2006 till 2011. Susan will lead the panel discussion for the next hour, and then the panel will answer questions from you, our audience. If you wish to have a question asked, please print it clearly on the card provided to you and give it to one of our staff members. Rob, Shmuel, David, Susan, we turn the program over to you.
Thank you. Is this working? I just want to make sure everyone can hear. This is kind of a historic moment for us because the four of us work together but don't always talk about the topics that we're going to be talking about tonight. We talk about how to get the paper out. We talk about, did you file on time? We talk about, when are you going to finish writing? We talk about the day-to-day existence of what we should do. But to sit down and actually have a conversation about the topics that we all think about all day long is really a special moment for us. And we come from very different places, but we come together as friends. And so that's one of the wonderful things about the Journal. I think you can say that the Journal is a place where everyone can come together from different places, but come together and feel like a community. So I feel really good about this conversation that we're going to have, except it'll be really interesting if they start to attack each other.
Susan doesn't know that Rob and I shut the door to my office and have serious arguments.
Yeah. So in a way, this is a historic moment, which is a great thing. And I want to start with Shmuel. I want to start with some factual, on-the-ground information from his observations of what's going on in Israel right now with the coalition building. I know it's not there yet, but I wanted you to kind of describe to us where it is and what's going on.
Well, we don't know. The real answer is that we don't know. Prime Minister Netanyahu was re-elected, and he was going to be Prime Minister again. But what coalition he's going to have as a supportive cast is yet unclear. He has two main options. One of them will get into a coalition of 67 members. That is the natural, straightforward, right-wing religious coalition, Likud, Kulanu of Moshe Kahlon, the Jewish Home, the two Haredi parties, Shas and the United Torah, Judaism. They can, if they come, and Avigdor Lieberman's party, if they come all together, they have 67 seats in the 120-seat Knesset. It can be a stable coalition as long as all of its members are happy. If one member isn't happy, then trouble begins, because each party can dramatically destabilize this coalition. Even the smaller parties, United Torah, Judaism, and Avigdor Lieberman's Israel Beitenu, only have six seats. So they cannot officially topple the coalition. They can only bring it from 67 to 61. But we already know that ruling with the 61-seat coalition is almost impossible in Israel. So it's a coalition that can work as long as it is coherent. And it is a coalition that the other half of Israel is going to really hate. That's one of the disadvantages it has. The other disadvantage is that the rest of the world is going to hate this coalition. The other option for Netanyahu, if there is such option, and we don't know, is to have some kind of unity government. Namely, to ask the Labor Party, or as they were called in this election cycle, the Zionist camp, to join his coalition. And then he can easily form a coalition of 77 seats with Likud, Labor, Moshe Kahlon, and the two Haredi parties. That 77 seats, it's a very stable coalition that no one has any interest to topple. The one problem, or the two problems that Mr. Netanyahu might have with such coalition is, first, we don't know if he really wants it. It will solve many problems for him, but it will create new problems, and it might alienate voters on the right. And Netanyahu always knew how to take care of his base first. He already thinks about the next election and the fifth term. So he needs to think whether he wants to alienate his right-wing base by joining forces with the Labor Party. The second problem is that we don't know if the Labor Party is willing to come. We can safely, or fairly safely, assume that the leader of the party, Yitzhak Buzhi Herzog, would probably come and join such coalition. But within the Labor Party, there are strong voices opposing such move and claiming that for the Labor Party to keep joining coalitions led by Likud is a recipe for keeping the Labor Party in a secondary position within Israel's political life. And that's why it is not clear if Herzog is a strong enough leader of the Labor Party to get them to join a coalition led by Netanyahu. It'll take a few weeks before we know.
So I'm gonna turn to Rob and David now and ask both of you if Herzog were to join as with this unity coalition, how would that change the relationship, say, with Washington?
I think it would improve it. I mean, I think it would improve it. I think that he's a popular figure in Washington. Michael Oren, who's with Kulano, is certainly a popular figure in Washington, and I think
Michael is going to be he might
have a higher position in a Herzog government, in a Herzog Netanyahu government, and I think it would take the temperature down a little bit. I don't know if that's a reason that Netanyahu would do it, but I think that would be an effect of it.
It would be an effect from the U.S. standpoint. David, what do you?
Well, first of all, I disagree with Shmuel.
Already? We just begun.
It's late at night. We got to keep him up. I disagree with Shmuel on the 77. I would much rather have a coalition with Likud, Zionist Camp, Kulanu, and Yesh Atid. And we can keep the Haredi out of the coalition because I think they're corrosive.
Is that a
force.
Possibility?
Well, I think it is. It's 75. That would be 75, not
right.
77.
It's only two.
But those two Haredi parties, I have tremendous. Can you guys hear me? Yeah, I just resent them. I mean, first of all, they, Shas, they use the word Sephardic, and I'm offended by the fact that they use the word Sephardic. They're not Sephardic. They're Sephardic who've been bastardized by the Haredi black hat mentality of intolerance, and that's not the Sephardic way. So I have a major problem with a party like Shas, who basically will sell their souls as long as you give money to their yeshivot. And as long as they can keep all the students really dumb, they won't learn computers, so they can all vote as a block, and they sell them amulets during the election. So I have a big problem with Haredi parties, and I would much rather see a coalition without the Haredi party. And I totally agree with Rob. I think it's about time that we upgraded our image internationally, and as long as we have extremist parties in our coalition, that's not going to happen.
I don't think that there'll be a problem if we do have a unity government in Israel. I know that there's a group of rebels now within the Likud. One of them is my cousin, and all some of these new guys. A lot of them are really Sephardic, and they're really pushing against, you know, a coalition government. And they call it, you know, we promised our voters we're going to have a nationalistic coalition. So that's going to be very problematic. But I think if Bibi put the interest of Israel first, he would create this kind of a governing coalition. And if they ended up making any peace moves with the Palestinians, it would never be a problem, because the Palestinians will always say no.
Do you want to respond?
Yes.
I think Shmuel wants to respond to this.
Yeah, well, first of all, I'm not sure if we disagree. I didn't say I prefer a coalition with the Haredis, but a coalition with Yesh Atid, I don't think such coalition is in the cards. Both the Likud and the Labor parties have huge interest in making Lapid and Yesh Atid go away. Yesh Atid takes votes from the Labor Party. So if there is a shared political interest for Netanyahu and Herzog, one of their shared interests is to get rid of Lapid, put him in a position of being an opposition leader of an insignificant party.
But does that disappoint you, Shmuel, that they don't see the greater benefit of the country and they're looking at it only for their own interest?
It disappoints me, but that's the way politics works. I must say that for a prime minister, having the Haredi parties within a coalition, there is something very calming about it, in the sense that these parties are always, they never make trouble. They have a list of fairly modest demands that take care of their constituency, and then they do not interfere with other matters.
But don't they want to undo some of the progress that was done by Yesh Atid in terms of having them work?
They will undo some of the progress. They would undo it under a Labor government as well. Herzog would give them the same things.
But they wouldn't do it if they were not in a coalition.
Yeah, but they will be in the coalition. So that's one thing. The second thing I wanted to say is about Likud rebels. Likud rebels are not a problem. Within the Likud party, people realize that the 30 seats they have in the Knesset, these are all Bibis.
Yeah.
He did it all by himself, and he has the power to get his party to do currently whatever he wants.
Including coalition?
The problem is rebels at the Labor Party, the party that did not succeed as much in the election, in this party, and with Herzog not being as strong within his party as Netanyahu is within Likud, that's the problem, not Likud rebels.
Okay. So let's sort of lean into Iran, since this is all where it's all going. Yesterday, President Obama said that he would sign a bill allowing Congress to have a say in the final negotiations with Iran. And the New York Times said this is a really bad idea. I want to hear from each of you what you think about that agreement that happened yesterday, or that movement that happened yesterday, and also how that affects Israel. Because we were hearing from Israel that the Israelis felt very good about this. We can start with David and go back this way.
I mean, the Israelis have been on the defensive on this, so any little glimmer of good news, they're gonna sort of grab onto and say it's good, because you know they've been at serious disagreement. Prime Minister Netanyahu and Obama, obviously, so. I think they're going to try to make some...
David,
can you hear me now?
Push your thing in a little closer.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, that's better.
Can you hear me now? That's my voice. I was born with a microphone, so I'll just project. I think the Israelis have an interest in making anything look good for them, because they've been on the defensive. So the agreement yesterday in Congress, I think, is a positive step, because Congress deserves... You know, we deserve to have a say in such a major agreement, and we are represented by Congress. So I think that's a positive step. Whether it's going to make any genuine difference, I'm not sure. You know, we have to assess so many moving parts here. You know, you got, on the one hand, you got a leader of America who's incredibly eager to make a deal. On the other hand, you got an opposing side with the Iranians who are incredibly eager to take us for a ride. And in the middle, you have us, the people, who are, you know, trying to figure out what to do, and we being represented by Congress. So I'm not sure whether the agreement yesterday has the teeth that are required to really make a difference. But we're going to obviously talk about this further tonight.
I disagree with the New York Times, which is something I don't often say. I think that Obama agreed to let this, to not veto this bill, because it doesn't really have teeth. I think that for, and people talk about the Iranians playing Obama, but I think Obama played the Republicans on this. I think that he managed to get a bill through Congress, this bill, which makes it look like Congress is going to have a say, and which Congress gives Congress the cover to say they had a say, but which ultimately, in order, they'd have to, I mean, the deal would have to be so bad, and so many congressmen, senators would have to vote against it. I don't see that happening. So I think it gave Congress the cover. It gave Obama pretty much a clear path to the end of the deal. And I think he managed it quite smartly, if, you know, his end goal being wanting to get a deal.
But I find that really sneaky on his part, because either you agree with the principle that Congress deserves a say, or you don't. And I would appreciate if the president would be more forthright.
No, they'll get a say, they just won't get a veto. They'll get a say, but they won't get a veto, and I'm not so sure that they should have a veto over these kinds of foreign policy decisions.
As I understand it, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but as I understand it, Congress made put in place some of the sanctions against Iran, and some of the sanctions are presidential sanctions, and that what it is that he can't override the congressional ones anyway, and so what he's agreeing to is what's already existing
right. Legally.
Is that right?
Right.
Okay. So in a sense, he's agreed to something that he had to agree to in the first place?
Right.
Well, but he can do a waiver, presidential waiver of the sanctions. So now he's not going to be able to do it for like 30-some days while they sort of assess it. But we'll see.
Shmuel.
Well, I'll tell you a story. About 2.5 months ago, or 3 months ago, I don't remember, when the... just a week after the Netanyahu speech in Congress was announced, I wrote an article for the New York Times saying that I don't think that's a good idea.
His speech?
The speech, okay. Yes. That I didn't think the speech, I didn't think Congress was the right venue in which to make such speech. I thought it then, and I still tend to think same way today. 3 days later, I was driving from Tel Aviv, from my home in Tel Aviv, to Jerusalem, and my telephone rings, and a voice I did not expect asks if I'd be willing to talk to the Prime Minister. So I pulled aside, and the Prime Minister was on the line, and I thought he was going to get angry with me for my article, and he said, no, I just want to explain my position. And his position, or what he said at that time, is exactly the thing that happened tomorrow. His hope was that something of the sort that happened tomorrow is going to happen. The Prime Minister of Israel essentially believes that he no longer has any chance to convince the President of the United States that his idea for this certain agreement with Iran is a bad idea. And hence, for him, the last, measure of last resort is to rely on Congress and hope that Congress will do something about it. That's the only thing he has short of war. Now, the Prime Minister might decide later that Israel has to do something militarily about Iran. But if, until then, or if he doesn't do such thing, his only hope right now is the American Congress. And for him to watch Congress beginning to move in that direction, and that's what happened yesterday. President Obama did not agree to the legislation. He was forced to agree. He realized that he does not have enough votes, or that the proponents of the legislation have enough votes to override his veto, and he didn't want to humiliate himself by trying to veto the legislation and then being overridden by Congress. So he decided to agree to the legislation. For the Prime Minister, this is a small victory. It's not a huge victory. It doesn't yet sabotage the agreement with Iran, but it's a small step in the right direction. Whether it will lead to something more significant, again, it's too early to say. Much of it depends on the final outcome of negotiations with Iran. The U.S. doesn't yet have an agreement with Iran. There are many differences, and it might be the case that by June we will discover that the framework doesn't turn into an actual agreement. And if there is an agreement, it depends how bad the agreement is going to be and how persistent Congress is going to be about holding the agreement to a certain standard.
It's important to remember, too, that before Bibi's speech, the big debate, the big discussion was on the Kirk-Menendez bill, which was all about we will tighten the sanctions if there's no agreement. And that was the majority of the debate was on the Kirk-Menendez deal. And then since Bibi's speech, the whole debate opened up. And all of a sudden, you know, there were hundreds of articles that were written about the deal itself. And I think the word got out that so many people didn't really realize the extent of the nuclear infrastructure that was going to stay in Iran as part of this deal. And I think for me, what I saw was that it created a very healthy debate, that all of a sudden we were talking about the merits and the actual deal itself. So regardless of the protocol and maybe how President Obama was offended by the way it all came down, I think the debate was upgraded.
Rob?
You know, it's funny. In some ways, I feel like it's debating ancient history. That was, what, already a month ago? We're already on four covers ago.
It happened, right? And it happened.
It was an incredible story by the Jewish Journal, the whole Bibi Gate thing. You know, except for wars, every week we had stuff on it. It was just, it wouldn't go away.
Well, I tend to agree with Shmuel. I think that it was a misstep by Bibi. I think that it really hurt relations with the president, with Israel's greatest ally. I think that it hurt I meant America when I said Israel's greatest ally. I think that it hurt Netanyahu's standing among American Jews, and the polls have borne that out. And I think that it's, as far as the Menendez bill, I mean, there was a lot of Democrats lined up to support that bill, which would have been a bill with real teeth, which could have derailed the whole thing. And because of what Bibi did, the Democrats pulled out, and that bill never made it. So I think that it backfired, and I think there was a misstep. We moved on beyond that now. But I would agree.
We can come back to Iran in a minute, but the Jews aren't so happy with Obama either, American Jews. I mean, that's going down, that the support for Obama is going down as well.
Nobody's happy with anybody. I mean, I think
that's what I'm saying.
I think this happens like when the parents fight. Like, you just kind of are mad at everybody. And I think that, you know, Bibi's popularity among Americans, not American Jews, but Americans is like 38%, which is lower than Obama's popularity.
Right.
Obama's popularity with American Jews has gone down about 12%.
Yeah. It's about 50%.
Obama's popularity in Israel, don't even get started.
Yeah. We didn't yet invent the numbers. Numbers low enough to describe his popularity.
I don't know if you read one of my last column, but I was at a Seder table with my sister-in-law who's from Israel, and when we did the 10 plagues, I heard her say, Obama, 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 Obama.
It was the 11th.
And she's Sephardic, so at the end they take the glass and they throw it against a rock. I mean, they don't mess around.
A famous rabbi in Israel who's considered a relatively moderate rabbi compared President Obama just a week ago to
Riskin.
To Haman.
And then he apologized, but then he I don't think he meant the apology.
Yeah, then he apologized.
Yeah.
Look, there's some serious stuff that's gone on. And I think at some point, you know, you can go too far. And I really think Obama went too far. Because look, there are 200,000 people being murdered in Syria, and all of a sudden, you know, Bibi makes a couple of mistakes that he says during the election, and Obama goes completely berserk on him. He gets incredibly offended, and he says, "Well, we're going to have to reassess."
Obama goes completely berserk. That I have not seen. I mean, he's not. I mean, not I'm not going to stand up for Obama, but
no. Well, look, he got angry. He got really angry.
By Obama standards, it was a completely.
There was a tiny.
The words I was hearing in the press.
He lost his cool.
He was enraged.
He was angry. It's true.
First of all, he was enraged at the way the whole speech thing happened with Bibi. But I think if you go back to the start of Obama's tenure, I think from the very beginning, the relationships got poisoned when he decided that he was going to put so much pressure on Israel for a settlement freeze. And if you recall, that was the very first thing. When he first met Bibi in April, that he got elected a couple of months after he came into the office, and it sort of set the tone and it poisoned the relationship from the very beginning, because this was not a sort of reasonable freeze outside of the settlement blocks. This was a draconian freeze, whereas if you wanted to upgrade your bathroom in Efrat, you had to call the President of the United States. So I think he went so far, he asked of the Israelis more than the Palestinians asked of the Israelis. And in a way, he took a peace process that was in the emergency room and he put it into a coma. So even if you're a liberal leftist who loves peace, really, Obama really hurt the peace process from the very beginning. And I'm not sure he ever recovered. Really, I'm just not sure he ever recovered from that beginning. And that was like 6 years ago. And we've seen, you know, this ebb and flow. And I think, you know, the low point recently in the last month was the reaction to Bibi's mistakes on the last day of the election, where he was saying, well, I understand that Bibi apologized for what he said about the Arabs, and I understand that he's retracted his statement on the two-state solution, but it wasn't good enough for President Obama. And I think the American Jewish community saw a lot of this, and they said maybe he's gone too far.
Rob?
Well, I think Obama did go, he lost his cool right after the election. I think he should have ignored all that stuff. I think he was hurt. And offended and upset and enraged.
He was disappointed. He thought someone told him that Bibi was going to lose.
No. I don't mean about that. No, I think so too. Yeah. I think that's it too.
He was the only one believing the Israeli polls and thinking that.
But I also think he was hurt. He was offended by this, by coming to Congress, and he lashed out, and I thought he should have just kept his mouth shut. I take a more nuanced view, I think, of what the actual history. I think I agree with David, actually, that the settlement freeze was a big mistake and unnecessary. It was kind of one of those...
I've worked on him for 3 years.
No, it was an unnecessary self-inflicted wound. I agreed with you in the beginning. I came to that conclusion early on, too, and I think that was Rahm Emanuel's doing to some extent, and Obama kind of naively went along. But look, there's also... something that Netanyahu mentioned in his speech to Congress. There's been deep, and you could talk to many Israelis, you could talk to many Americans, diplomats, there's been deep cooperation on security and defense and at very high levels, going back to America's support for Israel during the last incursion into Gaza, at the level of military and defense and technology and things, and at the UN, Obama has stood behind Israel. And I don't think he's Haman is what I'm saying. I think that to paint him that way really undercuts the important things that the importance of the relationship that's gone on.
Yeah, and I agree with everything Rob said about the cooperation on a security level. But there's a kishkes thing that's going on here, which is what does Obama choose to be offended by? So like I said earlier, there's his people in Iran, the letter of Iran says, death to America. There are Americans now, in jail, in Iranian jails, and massacres are happening all over the Middle East. Christians are being murdered, and Obama is offended because Bibi didn't call him for a speech. And he's just offended, and I'm offended by that. So So I think some of the stuff that, when I say he's gone too far, is what he chooses to be offended by. And I think he's been so offended by so many things that Israel has done. He's been so often offended by Netanyahu, while he's turned a blind eye.
Yeah, but you know, he's a president. We have a president now who could do more than two things at once. So he's offended by Bibi. Okay, he's offended, and whether you agree with he should be offended or not, fine. But at the same time, he also sent, you know, drones into Pakistan. He sent planes to, you know, bomb ISIS. He defended the Yazidis on the mountain. It's not that he hasn't worked on those other issues, but he happened to be offended by Bibi. I think it's a toxic relationship. You know, Bill Clinton was a big fan of Israel, no fan of Bibi. Bibi rubs Israelis the wrong way too. You know, he's not pure in all this.
I want Obama to be offended by evil.
Yeah. Shmuel, do you want to enter into this conversation?
Do you think Obama is pro-evil or anti-evil?
Look, the history of Israel with American presidents is complicated, but it tends to follow certain patterns. The most successful presidents, or those who had the most successful relations with Israel, could pressure Israel and bring it to and convince it to do things that it did not intend to do initially.
So give us some examples.
But the way to do it, look at President Clinton. President Clinton is an excellent example. The way to go about with Israel is first to gain the confidence of Israelis. One has to really look at the way Israelis see the American president. For Israelis, the American president is truly the only important, powerful friend they have in the world. I once wrote an article for the British Guardian about that, and since the Brits understand rain, I wrote that for Israelis, the president is the man who holds the umbrella above their heads. For Israelis to get a president, the first thing Obama did when he came into office, on the first day,
he called Abbas.
No, he appointed former Senator George Mitchell.
Right.
To implement a plan for a peace process, and Israelis realized that this was not going to be a plan that will be to their liking. Then he went to Cairo, made a terrible speech in Cairo, did not bother to visit Jerusalem. Then he met Netanyahu in Washington and started pressuring him. He did not invest in any confidence-building measures before going on the attack. Now, as I said, previous presidents did convince Israel to do all kinds of things, but first they realized that they need to gain some confidence, that Israelis should see them as friends before they are convinced to take all kinds of risks for peace or to prevent war or for whatever reason. Barack Obama, for some reason, assumed that he can do whatever he wants with Israel and that Israel will have no choice but to abide by his instructions. And Israel resisted that. The Israeli public resisted the demands made by Obama, and the Prime Minister of Israel resisted these demands, not always in the wisest way. Rob is right. Netanyahu has a way of rubbing people the wrong way. He's not the most beloved prime minister we ever had. He's not the most convenient person to get along with. But he resisted Obama knowing that the public basically support him and not the president of the United States. And if the president thought, and he thought that when he came to Israel, that he could speak above the heads of the prime minister and his minister directly to the people and convince them to do something, he failed because Israelis did not trust President Obama. And that's why everything that we see in the last year is a result, a late result of what happened initially. The whole beginning of these relations were not done in a smart way, and it impacted the last 6 or 7 years. And that's why every time we have even a tiny disagreement, it immediately becomes a huge disagreement, because there is no trust, the administration leaks to the New York Times against Israel, Israel leaks back. Instead of talking privately and confidently with one another, they speak to the publics above the heads of one another, and it turned out badly.
I think along with that, I agree, I think Obama's done a really bad job of communicating his agenda to the American Jewish public as well. He had 30 Jews come through his office yesterday, you know, the kind of the top leadership. It was all off the record, so now all these erroneous reports are coming out of what happened. But he really should have done that at the beginning of these negotiations, in the middle of these negotiations,
right.
During the negotiations.
Only the second time he's done
he
it.
Has not been a he hasn't been a great communicator on his agenda. So there's been it's first of all allowed people to create untruths about him, but also created a lot of mistrust, even about people who are prone to believe him.
Well, if you recall his very first meeting with the Machers in the White House, somebody brought up the statement. He said, "You know, Mr. President, you know,
David.
We're used to having a relationship where there's no daylight between Israel and America, right?" And then Obama's response was, "Well, you know, there hasn't been any daylight for the past 8 years under President Bush, and it didn't get us very far." So the implication clearly was that it wasn't going to bother him to have daylight between Israel and America, although we've always had daylight over the decades.
Daylight, there's been weak light.
Always had issues.
Klieg lights.
He went on the record saying there's going to be daylight between us, certainly relative to the 8 years under
which Bush. Also did not bring much success
right.
with the peace process.
Right.
If we need the proof that the issue of daylight does not have much implications for the peace process, we now got it. Whether we have a daylight or no daylight, the peace process is problematic for other reasons.
Right.
Where are we on the peace process, Shmuel?
Nowhere. Look, the problem with the peace process, and the problem I always have with Americans when I try to explain to them the problem with the peace process, is that Americans, I think, have this tendency to believe that if you put enough smart lawyers in one room for enough time, you'll get an agreement. Israelis and Palestinians have smart people in one room for several decades now, and there's still no agreement. And that is because the price of the product, when you try to sell a car for $1 million, and the buyer is willing to buy it for $100,000, there is no agreement to be made. It's just the differences between the two sides are just too great. The minimum that Israel is willing to offer the maximum that Israel is willing to offer is less than the minimum that the Palestinians are willing to accept, and the maximum that the Palestinians are willing to go for is less than the minimum that Israel is willing to accept. And that's why there is no agreement. And no American president can change that, because these things have deep roots in both societies. And some internal dynamics within Israel and within Palestinian society have to take place before the two people can come to a resolution that can get them closer to an actual agreement.
I think that's the optimistic view. I think it's a lot worse than that. We have spent so many years, especially in the liberal community, telling the world and telling the Palestinians that a Palestinian state will guarantee that Israel remains a Jewish democracy, that it's this incredible thing for Israel, that only a Palestinian state will give us this gold at the end of the rainbow, which means that we will remain a Jewish democracy. So if I'm the Palestinians, I say, well, if it's good for Israel, why should I want a Palestinian state? And I think that the animosity is so deep that the Palestinians want to hurt Israel a lot more than they want a state. And that's the bottom line. So this is an emotional thing. This has nothing to do with borders. It has nothing to do with, you know, all the stuff that lawyers talk about. I think this is a very emotional thing. I think there's a culture of resentment. There's a culture of shame, a culture of humiliation, a culture of grievances, a culture of victimization. A lot of it justified, but it's so ingrained and it's so emotional that at this point, they can't see beyond hurting Israel.
So, Rob, what do you say?
Oh, I agree with David. I mean, I think that, you know, one of our reporters was talking to one of the lead negotiators with the between the Palestinians and the Israelis, and he said it was whatever the Palestinians would ask for, he would just play a game where he would say the Israelis have agreed, mm-hmm. and they would change it. They would say no because they're not ready to make an agreement. I think there's many Israelis who aren't ready to make an agreement for good reasons, some for not such good reasons. I think that it's not, you know, there's a lot of people think, well, if we could just get the leaders in a room, they'd come up with the solution. If the leaders would only lead, if the leaders, I think the leaders are actually closer to some degree, the elites are closer than the people. Mm-hmm. And I think that, especially true of the Palestinian people, I mean, you're talking about people who have been fed a line of BS for so long in their media and everywhere else, and by their leaders. And I just see it as, you know, I agree with Shmuel. I just don't see anything happening for a while because the populations aren't ready, and primarily the Palestinians aren't ready.
Well, something is going to happen. The Palestinians were led to believe in recent years that there is a path for them for statehood or for something other than talking to Israel.
They believe that they
could go through international processes and organizations and achieve their goal, that they can force Israel to accept something much more preferable to the Palestinians than what they can get through negotiations. So that's the path they chose to go now, and this is what they're going to try for their next several years. And one of the big issues that Israel might have with President Obama and the Obama administration, and we keep talking about Iran, because Iran is now front and center, and it's really money time from now until June on Iran. So nobody talks about the Palestinians. But there is still hanging above Israel's head, there is the implied threat by President Obama to support a UN Security Council resolution that will make some demands related to the Palestinians. And if such resolution passes, it will put Israel on the spot. It'll be very threatening and very troubling to Israel, because such resolution is going to ignite other processes in international courts, processes related to BDS. All kinds of things can happen as a result of such resolution. And if Israel cannot count on a U.S. veto of such resolution at the Security Council, and I'm not sure it can, then this could be the next crisis we'd have to talk about when I come here next year.
I want to ask if there's no peace process over 20 years. I mean, if things don't get any closer over the next 20 years, and I've watched it for 35 years or whatever as a young adult and now, I mean, where are we?
Well, 20 years ago, we said that the situation was unsustainable.
Right.
We can still say 20 years from now. It will still be unsustainable. Look, the situation is not ideal. I'm not happy with the fact that Palestinians in the West Bank do not have full political rights. It's a problem. It's a moral problem And I don't want to underestimate the severity of the situation for the Palestinians.
But I'm not talking about that. I'm actually talking about whether or not it's a threat to the sustainability of Israel.
It's the current situation. If the rest of the world goes away and does not bother Israel, the current situation is manageable. It's not ideal, but it's manageable. There is a fence or a barrier separating Israelis from Palestinians. There is a Palestinian authority that runs the lives of most Palestinians in the West Bank. Those in Gaza are run by the government, the poor government of Hamas. The situation is manageable, and as far as Israelis are concerned, we can keep going that way. Now, again, should we be happy with the current situation? I don't think we should be happy with it, because there is a moral problem here, and long term something needs to happen.
I think it's a little bit more dangerous than that. It's not just the moral problem. I mean, we act as if it's just, or Israel acts, or American Jews act as if it's just up to us, but there's a lot of other actors in this. There's the world.
Yeah, you said if everything else stays the
right,
same, but
things
it doesn't.
Don't stay the same. Mm-hmm. So you're talking about another round of fighting in Gaza, another intifada. Each time it gets worse and worse. I mean, the price you pay for that is horrendous. And I think that the price Israel is going to pay in the international community, the price kids on college campuses are paying.
That's the real price is the problems Israel is going to have with the international community. And David will again say, and rightly so, that if the international community wants to solve serious problems, it should go to Syria first, and Israel.
That's not what I was going to say.
Second, third, or seventh.
No. I was going to disagree with you on one thing.
Okay.
Because I agreed with definitely the second part of what you said, but there's one thing you said I disagree with, which is that the Palestinians are using all this pressure from going to the international community, the United Nations, the Criminal Court, and so forth, to hope to get a better deal. And I disagree with that. I think that's wrong. I think the last thing the Palestinians want is the end of the occupation to get a better deal. The occupation is their mother's milk. It's a lucrative industry. It keeps the millions coming. Their real interest is to bash Israel, to diminish Israel, to destroy Israel. And as long as Israel stays there, that's why they have no interest in making a deal. Their number one interest is to bash Israel. They're not using these threats of going to the international thing to hope to get a better deal. Now, having said that, it's a real problem. It's even worse than what Shmuel and Rob said. It's a real, real problem. Because ultimately, we got to do something about this. And the fact that Israel is being blamed for the lack of peace, primarily blamed, I think is criminal. And something needs to happen. Look, as much as I'm a BB supporter, I got to tell you, I wish he would have done more to sort of take the spotlight away from Israel and put it on the Palestinians. What Rob said a few minutes ago was brilliant. He said, you know, no matter what you say, they always say no. You know, if we left Judea and Samaria overnight, if we said, here, take it all, take the Kotel, take this, take East Jerusalem, they will never say yes.
No, I think actually if we said that, they'd say try us. No. I don't know if I'd go that far.
They wouldn't say yes. They can't. That's why. Call them the Palestinians.
They'll say yes, but
saying yes.
They will say yes, but they will not say this is the
end
of conflict.
Right. Well, that's what I mean. They can never end the conflict. This conflict is a really lucrative industry for the Palestinians, especially the leaders. And I think they've done a disservice to their people. They've done an injustice to the Palestinian people who really want a better life. And I think they've been run by this corrupt sort of leadership. It's a real, real problem. I'll tell you, Palestinian state, you're going to have to ram it down their throat.
Well,
if Israel's going to ever create a Palestinian state.
You also have the problem of Gaza. Even if you solve the problem in the West Bank, you still have Gaza.
By the way,
so
there's something interesting that came up, Shmuel. This idea that Israel and Hamas are negotiating an independent state in Gaza. Did you read that a couple of days ago?
Yeah, there are such rumors from time to time.
It's a major mess. My friend Yossi Klein Halevi says, you know, giving up Judea and Samaria is an existential issue for Israel. Staying there is an existential issue. It's a mess. It's a mess because we all want to have a Jewish democratic state. It's a mess. And as much as I'm a, you know, as a real supporter of Judea and Samaria, it's a real mess. But the thing that makes it the biggest mess of all is that I don't think the Palestinians want to give us a get. I just don't. I don't think they want to divorce us.
Yeah.
You know? I think we're really lucrative for them.
Well, if they do divorce us, if they do divorce us, they'll be an even they'll have even larger problems. They'll need to create an economy. They'll need
right.
They depend on Israel to a large extent. They cannot divorce Israel. They have no viable economic life independent of Israel. At this time, who are they going to do business with?
I think for Israel, the question really is: so, when is the best time for Israel to reach some kind of settlement, to make some kind of deal? Because there will be a point, and Israel is very strong right now. Israel is still relatively strong in the international community. As much as people don't, you know, blame Israel, it's not like the Palestinians are that popular, especially in America. So, you know, the question I always have is. Is it going to get better or worse for Israel? And I'm not so sure it's going to get better.
Well, I think for Israeli decision makers, the question is different. What they do is they look at the situation and they say, can we get to a reasonable deal now? And if the answer is no, they wait for things to change, and hopefully someday, 10 years from now, 20 years from now. Or maybe 20 days from now, because things in the Middle East change so rapidly, they'll identify a window through which they can...
So what happens when the Palestinians say, you know what, you're right, we don't want a two-state, we don't want our own state anymore, we just want to be part of Israel?
So they'll say that.
And then what?
We'll say no.
But the international community...
They cannot force us to accept them as citizens.
But the international community is going to say, what's wrong with one man, one vote?
Again, the international community is going to make demands, and at some point, Israel, if the pressure becomes too problematic, Israel will have to take risks and do something.
Well, I think that's the key. I don't think that's a point to glide over. I think that's really, really an issue.
I agree.
Yeah. And here's the risk.
It is an issue. So Israel will have to... For example, Israel will have to say, okay, because of international pressure, we are going to take out 20 settlements.
Exactly. Okay? So the point is, do you do that under pressure, or do you do it with a little forethought?
I'm not...
And try to get a deal out of it.
Well,
I think that's the issue that Israel has to face.
If Israel doesn't think there is a deal, then you do it under pressure, and you drag your feet, and you hope that the more time... You play for time.
Right. That seems to be the strategy.
I disagree with both of you. I really do, because you guys are just, you're playing it too straight.
And we disagree with you.
You're playing checkers. You're playing checkers. You got to play Texas Hold'em. The idea is not that we're going to take a few settlements away. It's going to make us look even more guilty. If you read the Jewish Journal or you go in the archives, a few years ago, I wrote this. You take a... Take a peace plan, any peace plan. Clinton parameters, there's a whole bunch of them. There's Taba, there's a whole variety of them on the shelf. And you call a CNN a press conference, whoever you're the prime minister, whether it's Bibi or Rob Eshman or Susan, whoever. Say, I'm the prime minister of Israel. I have signed my name to this peace plan. Prime Minister Abbas, sign here and the conflict is over. That's what we need to do. It's okay. Not taking away a few settlements, because I guarantee you that the Palestinians can never say yes to end of conflict. So at some point, you got to have the pupik, the stomach, to be able to play poker.
So what happens in such...
To play poker.
Okay, so he doesn't sign. And then what?
You got to say, look, at the very least, I think you cannot underestimate, Shmuel, the importance of us being Israel, being blamed for the absence of peace. It's the source of BDS. It's a source of incredible condemnation all over the world, and I'm just tired of it. And I think at some point, the spotlight needs to be put, but you can't just do it with words and argument. It's got to be done in a concrete way. And this is what I would do. I would sign an agreement, say, Mr. Abbas, sign here, and the conflict is over.
I think that that's what happened in the end of the Clinton days, in fact. In those last days when Clinton was having that, at Camp David, having those last negotiations, they gave him a plan that they couldn't turn down.
And it happened again with Olmert, famous meeting between Olmert and Abbas, when Olmert gave him the map, and Abbas said, let me keep the map, and he said, okay, but sign
the map. Right.
But give me your signature, and Abbas said no.
Right, it's never public. It's never black and white. I think make it public, make it black and white.
And
all right.
Okay.
Let's go back to something fun like Iran. So what I wanted to do was move to the next American election cycle, which, believe it or not, is starting again. And Shmuel wrote a book for us on the last one. How is that going to change things? And let's I think a lot of Americans, especially on the college campuses, see Bibi as now, and Israel being aligned with the Republican Party. And I wondered if that's going to play out in this next election cycle, and who the Israelis might feel most comfortable with.
I want to go back to the Prime Minister of Israel calling Shmuel on the phone. Does he say, how's the family? What's up? How does that start?
He said, is this Shmuel of the Jewish Journal?
Seriously, how does that conversation start?
Manishma,
stop the car?
I did stop the car because I was afraid of the police, not because it was the Prime Minister. Yes, I did stop the car. And there was some small talk, but it was mostly business. He wanted to talk about his speech to Congress. He wanted to talk about Iran, and then we spoke about some other things, about some domestic affairs.
And what is the chance that the Prime Minister is calling the political editors of other Jewish newspapers in America? I don't think so.
I can't tell you. I can't give you an answer.
I don't
to
think
that.
So. Look, what a question.
Yeah, yeah.
I think that the Republicans, some Republicans, certainly not all, and either with intention or without intention, have turned Israel and Iran into a wedge issue. And I think that's a very, very dangerous thing. I think that the strongest asset Israel has, the strongest strategic asset it has, is its relationship with the United States, and that relationship depends on bipartisan support. And so to brand Israel as the Republican cause, and to say, as Representative Steen King said, that the Democrats are Democrats first and pro-Israel second, or whatever, or Jewish Democrats are Democrats first and Jewish second, which was a ludicrous thing to say, but goes out there and gets absorbed by people. I think it's incredibly dangerous for Israel. To the extent that it's really two issues. I think that Jews will vote for, Jews don't, they tend not to vote for the president based on his view toward Israel, his or her view towards Israel. It's about the fifth priority among Jews.
Seventh.
Depending on the poll, it's the fifth or seventh priority.
That's in the non-Orthodox Ashkenazi.
Well, the Orthodox vote has never put a president over the top. Yeah.
No, but I'm not saying it did. But
no, so I mean, I think that it's bad. I think that it's really bad in terms of support for Israel. In terms of how it's going to affect the election, it's unclear because, of course, that depends on who they run. It depends on who the Democrats run. It depends on who the Republicans run. And it depends what the big issues at the time are. I don't think that Israel is a definitive issue for Jewish voters. So, and I also think that because it looks like Hillary's going to be the nominee, she is very popular among Jews. She got a huge percentage of the Jewish vote in New York. Shmuel probably knows how many. And I think she'll get a large percentage of the Jewish vote in the upcoming election.
What do you think, Shmuel?
Back in 2002, in many of the states that Barack Obama was able to win, Hillary Clinton won the Jewish vote. So it is true that Jews, not the younger Jews, but most Jews did prefer her to him back in 2008. Look, Israel is probably going to prefer that the next president will be a Republican president. And that's because... Well, that's just, it's fact. Israelis tend to believe today that the policies in which that the Republican Party support are much closer to the view, to what most Israelis want. Rob raised an important issue, and it is much talked about issue of the importance of bipartisan support for Israel. And there's no doubt that Israel, for many years, relied on bipartisan support. And it is an important interest for Israel to have such bipartisan support. But here's why it becomes tricky to be the prime minister of Israel. Okay, it's a tough job. You have two things to consider. You have Iran becoming a nuclear power in the Middle East, and you have an important interest in keeping the support for Israel bipartisan in the United States. And at some point, you might get to the conclusion that you cannot have both. That if you want to stop Iran, you have to heavily rely on Republicans and lose some Democratic support because of that. Or you can say, well, keeping bipartisan support is so crucial that I'm willing to give up on some of the tools I have for Iran. And you, as Prime Minister of Israel, have to weigh these two issues and have to make a decision. And clearly, Prime Minister Netanyahu made the decision. It's not as if the Prime Minister is not aware of the bipartisan issue or doesn't understand that for Israel long term it is important to keep the support of the two parties. He understands it very well. However, when he looks at the current situation, he says, he probably says, I need to take care of Iran first and worry about bipartisan support later.
Right.
I have no choice.
Right.
I have to set a priority, and this is my first priority. It's not because he wants to alienate Democrats. It's not because he doesn't care about Democratic support. And I agree, there will be consequences. Israel is going to, the support for Israel among Democrats is going to suffer. But if the main interest for Israel now is Iran, and if his calculation is that his only chance with Iran is to rely on Republicans, this is the choice Prime Minister Netanyahu felt he had to make.
It's a strange choice, though, when the I'm sorry, David. It's the strange choice, though, when the president really is the foreign policy executive in our country. I mean, I'm not so sure it was a wise choice. What do you think?
I tend to accept the assessment of the Prime Minister that he did not have much chance with the president when it comes to Iran. I look at the president, I look at his actions. I interviewed Barack Obama before he was elected president about Iran.
Did he call you also?
We had... The answer, strangely, is yes. It was 2000...
Hillary Clinton's on the line.
Yeah, just a minute.
It was... Well, It's on the record. It's on the record. The interview was published by Haaretz, where I worked at the time. It was 2007, and Barack Obama was in the early stages of becoming a nominee for president. And he sponsored legislation for sanctioning Iran. He was one of the main sponsors, and they wanted to spread the word. They wanted Jewish voters to know that Senator Obama is sponsoring legislation about Iran. So, yes, he called me to say, well, there is this issue with legislation about Iran. Why won't you write about it? And he gave me this interview. But even then, it was clear from that interview that Obama intends to talk to the Iranians and that his intention is to try and amend the relations between the U.S. and Iran. This was his intention from the outset. He was very eager to have an agreement with the Iranian. And at some point, the prime minister made a calculated decision. And in this case, I must say, I think he was probably right that he cannot convince the president to refrain from having disagreement with Iran. And that's why he decided to rely on the Republicans on this issue. Now, I'm not naive. Netanyahu preferred Romney to Obama in 2012 before the issue of Iran became such a huge issue because of the Palestinian issue, because he thought he'd get a better deal with Romney on the Palestinian issue and maybe some other things. So it is true that for the current Israeli government, and I think for previous governments as well, it was very convenient both for Olmert and for Prime Minister Ariel Sharon to have President Bush in office during the very tricky years from 2000, the Second Intifada, the pullout of Gaza, the Second Lebanon War. It was easier for them to have Republicans in power at that time. And if you look at what Israelis prefer, I find it hard to believe that Israelis are going to prefer a Democratic nominee over the Republican nominee in 2016.
Okay, David, one sec, let me just make an announcement. Paul's going to be collecting the cards with other questions, so then I want you to, while he's doing that, go ahead. Okay. Sorry, David, you can talk while they're doing that.
Okay, well, you know, we got to keep things in perspective.
Yeah, people can let him talk.
I think after 8 years of Obama, it can't go anywhere but up.
Yeah.
And in terms of Israel, so there's a huge difference.
No, that's not true. We might find out that you can.
If you look, I'm just
it
assuming.
It can be worse.
I'm assuming Hillary Clinton will get the Democratic nomination. And I got to tell you, you should read. She did an interview this week with Jeffrey Goldberg. And she might as well, she sounded like a Likudnik. Now, obviously, you know, people are politicians and they say what they got to say. But, you know, there's a huge difference between Obama and Hillary Clinton. And not that I'm pushing for Hillary Clinton right now. We just got to keep things in perspective. A president that comes in and asks for a settlement freeze right away and that sort of, you know, all the stuff that's happened over the years with President Obama and even his sort of his eagerness to make a deal with Iran and the offenses that he took with Ramat Shlomo, with the thing that happened with Biden, and all these like moments of incredible tension, however much Bibi was responsible for it, I just don't see that happening with Hillary Clinton. So I think we just got to keep things in perspective.
Okay, so we have a lot of questions here, and we're not going to be able to do them all, but they're actually really...
I have a flight at 6 a.m.
Yeah, yeah. I'm told we have like 20 minutes, 15 minutes, okay. But they're good questions, and they're not speeches, although some of them are a little hard to read. But here's a good one, I thought. Because the Palestinians are going after Israel and the UN and the World Court and BDS, Isn't it more important that the next U.S. president be absolutely supportive of Israel with an absolute pro-Israel constituency? And this person says, meaning a Republican, and I'm going to let you answer that secondarily, meaning a Republican, or the first part, however you want to answer it. Rob, do you want to go first?
Yeah, I think the president should be pro-Israel. I think most, I can't think of the last anti-Israel president. Have we had an anti-Israel president? Carter. I'll give you Carter. I think, there is a sense of America's relationship with Israel has been pretty strong over the last 67 years. under both Republicans and Democrats, and it's also suffered under both Republicans and Democrats. I mean, I grew up under Reagan, where we were in the streets fighting against the hundreds of millions of dollars in weaponry he was giving to Saudi Arabia, which we thought was going to be used to obliterate Israel. Now, of course, my brother-in-law is flying to Saudi Arabia from Israel to do agricultural deals, so things do change sometimes. I think that by as long as there's a strong bipartisan relationship, as long as I don't think it matters greatly which party is in power in the White House. I think they both maintained, they both had ups and downs, and I think that the other part that's important is that you have strong support for Israel among the American public, and those numbers are still very high.
David,
and that's something we want to protect.
Well, like I said, I think that just the years with Obama were a little bit of an exception in terms of how we took on Israel. And I just don't think we're going to see that again for a long time.
David, I remember under George Bush, the first, there were vicious fights with Israel and vicious things said by James Baker. So vicious, in fact, that Republicans now are saying they're not going to support Jeb Bush because he's got James Baker. I mean, it's not, you make it sound like this is the first president to ever stand up to Israel.
No, I think there's a public aspect, the humiliation of Bibi when he came into the thing, and
James,
you know,
Baker
45 minutes of beating up Bibi because of the announcement of some building permit in a little section of Jerusalem that Hamas was already ready to give up. Ramat Shlomo, there was sort of an over-the-top quality to the criticism, to the animosity between the two that I just don't think we're going to see for a long time. It was something that was very sort of ugly in the fights between Israel and
okay,
America.
Yeah, we have a lot of questions, and so we should have short answers.
Sorry.
Okay. Okay, here's a short question. How likely is it that Israel will wage war on Iran if the agreement if the nuclear agreement deal fails?
Short answer?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Okay.
It depends on what the chief of the Air Force tells the prime minister in a closed meeting. They will not tell me in advance if Israel does or does not have the capabilities, and I do not want to know.
Right,
would Israel do it without American support?
It might. Yes, I don't think American support is going to be the one definitive issue.
By the way,
case.
In the Jewish Journal, we interviewed Congressman Ted Lieu during the election campaign, and we asked him, you know, if Israel decided to bomb Iran, would you still support Israel? And he said yes. Check it out, Jewish Journal Archives. We got him on the record.
Okay, here's one. Some say that Iran is now 2 months away from a bomb, but if this deal is implemented, as John Kerry expects, it would push back the clock to 1 year. So how is this a bad deal?
It will do it for 10 years, but then after 10 years, Iran will legitimately go back to 2 month breakout time, and this means that they will have a bomb.
And then during those 10 years, you've legitimized evil. You've given a kosher stamp to evil, and you've given evil billions of dollars that they can use to continue to wreak havoc throughout the Middle East. It's in my column this week, JewishJournal.com.
In my column.
But in, yeah, go on.
Well, I think the question's a smart one. I think that nobody knows what's going to happen in 10 years. Nobody knows what's going to happen in 1 year anymore. Look at the Middle East over the last 10 years. I mean, nobody would have predicted what's going to happen. So I think what you do is you go forward with the best deal you can get right now, and you put other deals in place to strengthen the allies in the region, to strengthen the Gulf states, to strengthen Saudi Arabia, to strengthen Israel, and you put in place agreements and treaties and military upgrades that would even more isolate Iran. So at the end of 10 years, Iran gets out of this deal and it's facing a really unified front in the Middle East. I mean, I think that's one possibility. I don't think it's a given. I don't think anybody knows, nobody up here, nobody ever, nobody anywhere really knows what's going to happen, but I think that's the best chance.
if, I guess the other part of that question is that if Israel did attack Iran, what would, I mean, we don't know the answer to this, I realize, but what is the outcome? How good is that for Israel in the world court and literally
if
in
Israel
terms of what
Israel is forced
effective?
To attack Iran, it is very bad for Israel. But again, this is, it's like the Iran versus bipartisan issue. These are two bad choices, and you have to pick the lesser evil. It's not as if Israel wants to have war with Iran, but Israel also does not want to have a nuclear Iran. And sometime in the future, an Israeli prime minister will have to decide which of these two options is worse.
Anything from either of you?
I think he's right.
Okay. What can Israel do about Russia selling Iran's surface-to-air missiles?
Nothing. You want the short answers?
Actually, they're selling Ukraine. That this is what I read today. That's one of the things they can do, is help an enemy of Russia, saying there are consequences.
I didn't read that. That's interesting.
Yeah.
I don't think Israel is in a position to wage a war on Russia. So, you know, Israel should be careful. It has enough enemies. It does not want to add Putin to its list of enemies. Israel cannot do much. It can try some convincing, some pressure. If the Russians are determined to do it, they'll do it.
Well, this question is sort of a follow-up to that, which it says, with the sale of the Russian missiles to Iran and the threat of Iran providing those missiles to Hezbollah because of the P5+1 agreement with Iran, doesn't this show that the failure of that the deal, it's already a bad deal?
I think it shows something else. The deal may or may not be a bad deal. I don't really know yet. And there's a lot of dispute. If you read many differing points of view, you'll see that there's dispute on both sides. But I think it also shows that this is not a deal just with Obama and Iran. There's a lot of other countries involved in this, and in the calculus of how you get to the best deal with Iran, you have to take into account the fact that other countries have other agendas that are competing. That one of the pressures that Obama talked about is that if these sanctions fall apart, if there's no deal, the sanctions fall apart, then everybody will be selling missiles to Iran. So you have to take that into account. It's not just about Israel, Obama, and Iran.
Well, I think one of the problems that happened is if you don't have a credible military threat, you really don't have the leverage to have a good deal. And when Obama kept saying, you know, I'm not bluffing, and we're leaving no options off the table, blah, 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 the Iranians didn't believe him.
They believed him the same way he believes Netanyahu when Netanyahu says he wants the two-state solution.
Exactly. They didn't believe him. It was a joke, so they never took him seriously, and I think he just lost his leverage. Because of that, he couldn't really get the best possible deal, and that was a big mistake that he made.
He's not the only negotiator, though. I mean, there's a whole
group
of
no,
countries.
But there's a lot of other negotiators.
I mean, we talk about it like it's two countries.
No, no, no. That was my point. There's a lot of
America's
other people in the room.
But the only one who can take him out militarily. In that standpoint, they're the only ones who can generate that leverage. And he failed to do that, and I think because Obama really, really didn't want to have any military action whatsoever. And it showed.
All right. Okay. Shmuel, I'm just pulling this one out of random, so let's see how we do. Could Obama's poor communicative skills with the other world leaders be due to an insecurity that he overcompensates with his arrogance? I want to give you a flavor of the audience.
I was not trained as a psychologist. I can't answer that question.
Okay, this actually changes the topic slightly, and it is an issue. What do we do about anti-Semitism worldwide related to the Israel-Palestinian problem, and is this a real problem?
That's for David.
That's a whole nother night.
Yeah.
My daughter needed a ride from dance. So... Where's the question?
The question was, what do we do? There's growing anti-Semitism worldwide, and what do we do about it?
Oh, boy. Right. Yeah.
Fix it.
Well, look, I mean, you know, I think Paul Johnson wrote something once that anti-Semitism, like a pathology, like no matter what, They're always going to find some kind of reason to hate the Jews. And I'm not an alarmist, but it's just going to be there no matter what. It's a question of containing it, minimizing it, isolating it as much as we can. And I think right now, the tragic irony of the Jewish story is that here's this thing that was going to supposed to reduce anti-Semitism and deal with it, which was Israel, has now become one of the biggest instruments for anti-Semitism itself, which I think is a tragic irony. But we just got to not sit back and just let it happen. We can't be too cynical or fatalistic or negative. We just got to, you know, take our future in our own hands and just have this attitude where we call the world out, and organizations like CAMRA and UN Watch, we have to confront the United Nations if we feel they're discriminating against Israel. A lot of what you see us doing, I think we're going to continue doing. And we really need a prime minister in Israel who's going to really prove to the world that we want peace, that we are not the problem in the Middle East. In fact, Israel is a beacon of hope for the Middle East. And I would love to see a more positive message come, a more empowering message come on behalf of Israel. And I think that will have a ripple effect against anti-Semitism.
I think the answer is you fight it. I mean, I think our natural reaction is we get very scared and we say, should we leave Europe? Should we leave it? Should we leave England? Should we run away from it? You stand and you fight it. Jews have never been more powerful in the history of civilization. The American Jewish community is beloved in America. It's wealthy. It's politically connected. It's powerful. So I think the fight should start with us because we are the most confident, the most comfortable, the most have the most resources, and we take the fight to Europe, and we take the fight wherever it is, and we stand up to it.
I told you I was working on him. Hey, look, where did he go, Rob?
My answer is very general. We should not be fooled to think that because we are strong, we don't have to be smart, and we should not be fooled to think that because we are smart, we don't have to be strong.
Okay, I'm gonna end on that.
Thank you
very
Susan.
Much.